Good afternoon, everyone. We have probably one of the largest panel for today. So let me start introducing the panel and why we have our the table set up. So as some of you probably know that we had a new initiative early this year. We started a TCFA FinTech and a Blockchain Institute in May. And our goal is really to create a cross-disciplinary platform to promote the knowledge and idea exchange from different fields in the industry, including the regulators, academia, industry startups, and investors. And we believe it's important for people from different parts of the industry to talk together and share their latest progress and also the challenges they face, and continue to work together to push the frontier in this space. So with that, when we think about putting together this panel, we really invited some leaders from key players from different parts of the industry. And here you can see we have a leading blockchain platform from Asia and one of the largest cryptocurrency exchanges in the world, and one of the most influential blockchain media company in China. Also a top fintech company from China and a leading consulting firm and a top tier global law firms. So I'm very thrilled to have such a great panel today. And also that for TCFA FinTech and the Blockchain Institute, we welcome everyone to join us. If you are interested to be part of this new initiative, please feel free to talk to me afterwards. And I want to take this opportunity to announce an important strategic partnership. So TCFA FinTech and Blockchain Institute just entered a partnership with ChainDD. You see we have one of the panelists here, and we entered this partnership. It's really to promote the efficiency and the transparency in the whole space and also in the financial space. So let me introduce our panelists. So we have Patrick Dai, and Patrick is the founder and CEO of Quantum Fund. Patrick is one of the earliest pioneers in discovering the blockchain technology, and he is also listed on the Forbes 30 Under 30 Asia list in 2017. And next to Patrick, we have Wilfred Dai. Wilfred Dai is head of financial markets of OKCoin USA. OKCoin is one of the largest global cryptocurrency exchanges. And next to Wilfred is Catherine Lee. Catherine is the US founding partner and the CEO of ChainDD. And ChainDD is a new spin-off from TMT Post Group, which is a top tier media, tech media company in China. And next to Catherine is Mr. Shen Liu. And Mr. Liu is the chief software architect of Unimobile Financial Technology. And he has submitted and received multiple patent inventions in the blockchain field. And next to Mr. Liu is Daniel Nathan, and Dan is the partner and also global co-chair of cryptocurrency practice at ORIC, a top-tier law firm. Dan has over 25 years as an enforcement lawyer with SEC, CFTC, so he's definitely representing a strong voice from the legal and the regulator side. And the last but not least is Kevin Stoffman. Kevin is has over 15 years of consulting experience. He's recently leading two blockchain pilot program in the real estate area. So I think given the tight schedule, I will run the panel by first to ask each of our panelists to take 5 minutes to talk about what do they view as the next breakthrough in the blockchain space from their own field. Then we'll ask panelists to answer two questions. If we have a time left, we'll open the question to the audience. Thank you.
Okay. It's a great honor to come here to share some insights about the blockchain industry. So my name is Patrick Dai. I'm the founder and the CEO of the Quantum Project. It's a pretty popular blockchain platform. in 2017, the highest market cap of the new build quantum platform was like $5 billion. But today, with the whole market crash and with the bearish market, it's $500 million. But it's still very impressive because we only started the project about 2 years. So from zero, you grow to $500 million. It's almost impossible in the traditional finance areas. So my opinion about the next breakthrough of the blockchain, I think I'm most agree with Dr. Xiao, his judgment. Like the first breakthrough, I think, come from the institution investors. That means like people will trade Bitcoin, will trade like all the cryptocurrency as a new alternative asset. It's a new type of asset that is different from stocks, different from debt, different from like all the derivatives. It's a totally new asset, natively born from the internet, not from the traditional financial world. It's born on internet. It's born, and it's a community on the asset, and it's been very popular among all the young peoples. So it's a totally new trend of the asset type. So if we are running a fund, or if we are running some like VCs, think about take like 1% of your portfolio in this new digital asset. I think it has that's one of the biggest breakthrough. Another very big breakthrough, I think, come from the based on the blockchain technology. You can build a totally new like a capital market. Can compare with the Nasdaq. I mean, the Nasdaq built on all the like information technology, all the internet technology. But with a distributed ledger, with the blockchain technology, you can build a more transparency and a better liquidity, like a capital market for the global. So I think that's a second breakthrough. Yeah, that's my ideas.
Okay, thank you, Patrick. Now let's hear from Wilfred from a cryptocurrency exchange perspective.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Wilfred Day. I want to offer some of the reflections of 2008, and maybe we can deal a little bit looking forward on 2019, what's going to happen there. And along the way, I'll highlight some of the advances and breakthrough, if you will, in the blockchain technology sector. In fact, in my view, the breakthrough occurs every day in blockchain space. It's just so such a new field. Blockchain and distributed ledger technologies are the catalyst for digital assets. 2018, this year, has been great for digital asset ecosystem. The massive digital asset sell-off we experienced this year filtered out a lot of noise traders in the market, as well as the tourists, if you will, in the industry. We took a deep breath and after the run-up of 2017 and prepared for institutional-ready environment for digital assets. Investment trading. The arms race for infrastructure build has already been begun. And for instance, recently ICE announced their plan to spin off a new company, Backup, focusing on institutionalization of digital assets and develop a payment use case. ETF issuers continue their way to gain acceptance from regulators despite few rejections over last like call that 16 months. Coinbase had made a significant amount of strategic investments in the ecosystem and fortified its leading institutional position in the digital asset ecosystem. As the industry evolves, institutional solutions aim at keeping digital assets safe have continued to develop, and that it has been a focus of 2018. Last month, Fidelity announced the creation of a digital assets services, a new division offered institutional-grade custody for digital assets and trade execution. Further, more traditional financial institutions such as Goldman Sachs, Bank of America, Morgan Stanley, Citigroup, Barclays, all involved in some form of a digital asset initiative internally. We have seen a growing number of large hedge funds, in particular macro funds, putting their feet in the ground for digital assets. not only the spot market evolved in 2018, also the OTC market, the derivatives market has been very vibrant on both exchanges and in terms of various type of products. So we have NDF products coming along. We have options market, European options market that trade on Ledger X, so on and so forth. In 2018, we saw Bitcoin's volatility went from 60 handle to 16 handle in recent trading sessions. The emergence of the stablecoin as a new asset class, if you will, proliferate the ecosystem and reflect the maturation of a cryptocurrency marketplace. Yet there are a few ways to go, in my view, but I stop there for the 2018 reflection. But in 2019, we will continue to see significant maturation for the institutional side.
Okay, thank you, Wilfred. And the media, let's hear what media's thoughts in the space.
Yeah, I would like to share in terms of how blockchain will impact media. But I think I want to also, first of all, share kind of how blockchain will significantly change the financial system as someone like myself working in Wall Street for 17 years. I have deeper experience in terms of seeing the future of the blockchain will significantly transfer the landscape for the investment. And everyone know as a professional in financial industry and investment, you know, the most important thing is trust and liquidity. So blockchain is a trust machine. So, a lot of assets on chain and transaction on chain cross distributed ledger and create a more transparency with traceability. And smart contract also could enable better risk management. And in starting 2017, I think everyone heard about ICO, and now we talk about STOs. And it's basically all the security, tokenization really opened up the financial system and investment to a lot of people who are not currently included and with a much lower barrier to enter the market and have better access to a lot of investment opportunities. Wilfred mentioned, token exchange definitely is another way to offer a lot of liquidities and where people not only can invest in the project in the primary market, but also from a secondary market, you can find a good projects or good companies that you can invest or purchase token. So, and lastly, I think another innovation that Dr. Shao mentioned, account innovation always be the source of financial system innovation. I couldn't agree more with him. So that's why as a ChainDD, we're not only the media company, but also a fintech company where we think, a crypto wallet will become a bank, everyone use your wallet, not only just to deposit your digital assets and transfer and transact, but also manage your digital assets, which not only just include your financial assets, but also a lot of other digital assets as well in one place. So I think that would actually significantly impact everyone's life in the digital future. As a media company, I think we also carry out the critical mission where we need to bring a lot of transparency to this market. Given the hype in 2017 and the market cooling down in early this year, and there's a lot of volatility in the cryptocurrency market. A lot of crypto fund manager and kind of questioning whether there is a good project, right? Whether the white paper is good enough for the project team to raise money, etc. We do believe there's still a lot of good ideas and projects, but how we can really educate more to people who are not very familiar with blockchain, how blockchain will impact their life, how we can work together and promote this project in a more positive and healthy way. I think that's also kind of how, as a media, we try to do. That's why we spun off of our parent company, TMT Post Group in China, and set up the U.S. company here, expand the presence, and you know, with our global vision, where we can educate people and really, you know, take a lead to create a forum, forum, and where people can really exchange ideas and work together to move forward this this technology. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. 我们下一位演讲嘉宾是刘总呢，是将会从就请刘总从他专业的角度来给我们分享一下他认为区块链领域的下一个突破口。团队可不可以放一下刘总的
slide？哎，大家好，我来自国内联动优势，联动优势是一个比较老牌的国内的一个第三方支付机构。它最早是2003年就开始做移动支付，相对是非常比较早的。它最早呢，它是跟中国银联、中国移动联合成立的一家公司，所以联动优势的前两个字分别就代表这两家股东公司。我们相对持有的牌照呢，相对也是比较全，但是这样带来一个后果呢，就是说。 我们的那个受的监管也会比较多，包括从银监会、外管局各个方面的，还有证监会各个方面，它发牌照的那个单位都对我们有监管职能，所以我对区块链的看法可能会相对比较保守一些。然后，下一页，关于区块链的看法，我主要是有三句话。第一句话呢，是从技术角度来看，
能不能放一下下一页？
技术角度从2018年再下一页，2018年的看呢，技术上它并没有大的突破。我们认为那个关于区块链其实有三波的技术的一些浪潮，第一波其实在比特币诞生的时候呢，它实际上是把传统的密码学的所有的知识做了一个大的集成。集成在它精密的集成在它一个系统里面，完成它特定的一些功能场景。然后在第二波呢，它是第二波的话，就是说联盟链诞生了之后，以及随着联盟链的一些新的需求，尤其是关于隐私保护的需求，它把大量的这个密码学的一些前沿性的知识，像盲签名啊、环签名啊、同态加密等等。 把它综合起来了，然后提出了更高的需求。这样的话，它把一些活跃在一些很冷门的一些密码学专家都全部把它激活起来了，并且把让他们从实验室的环境进入了大众的视野。那么下一步是什么呢？下一步有可能是要进行一些真正的商业化的落地以及大规模的使用。这方面可能还要引入很多大量的一些其他的一些技术体系。这里面。 目前到底是哪些技术呢？还没有完全确定。但是在2018年的时候，这方面其实都没有大的突破。从区块链整体事态来看呢，其实是用一手诗来讲，就是无处话凄凉，是相对比较冷的。第一方面呢，首先监管是非常严。从去年94那个发文7个部委发文之后，把那个 ICO 就一刀切了。 所有的 ICO 就完全清退清理，以及退出，所以很多区块链项目公司就只能是或者关停或者出海，所以整个币圈就基本上可以认为是凉了。那么对链圈而言呢，链圈而言就相对比较冷，所有的监管部门它更鼓吹的是叫无币区块链。 但是按肖峰总之前说的，就是说，如果没有一个数字货币作为去进行记账的话，它还叫不叫区块链？这其实是很存疑的。这里面还有一个事，就是说冷的是什么呢？就是最近那个网监办它出了一个相关的公告，信息服务就是区块链信息服务的提供者要进行的一些监管的要求。那这里面有一点就是说，它把目光已经不仅仅是停留在 做信息服务的提供者，而且包括了这个信息服务就包括提供者，就包括了技术方的提供者，进行你输出技术方案以及做相关的技术工具都是在它的监管范围内。这里面就发现做程序员的也会变成一个严防死守的一个对象，是变成一个高风险的职业了，所以这个币圈冷这也是一个很大的因素。在2018年，区块链企业它的首要的目标就是怎么努力的活下去啊。这个其实很容易理解，你可以认为把区块链企业的创业以及跟早期2000年前后早期的互联网创业同等起来。那在2000年左右的时候，也有泡沫破灭的时候，也大量的互联网企业关停。其实区块链企业也是站在这个关口上，所以你要怎么样努力的活下去，找到你挣钱的或利润的来源，才能够持续的经营下去。那么我们怎么看它这个利润，怎么去突破获得它相关利润？我们从三个维度来看。首先，它是要相当于是合法无风险、合法合规的。第二方面呢，它是要相对比较容易实现的，不去挑战太过于这种高并发高吞吐的一些场景。另外，它有足够的利润，它的商业模式比较成熟啊。那么如果三个方面都能够符合的话，那么我们看见供应链金融以及跨境的贸易金融以及大宗交易等等这方面确实有大量的利润空间。所以你就发现有大量的区块链企业都开始进入这个领域啊。最近那个商务部发布了一些试点的公告，包括50多个城市以及200多家企业可以进行一些区块链，但是中间的大部分还是由场景公司，所以很多区块链企业就开始跟这些场景公司、场景的一些企业进行一些紧密的结合啊。所以我个人认为它的下一个的风口，下一个的独角兽应该是出现在供应链金融这一类的领域中间，服务用区块链技术去服务实体经济啊，并且共同获得中间的一些利润和收益。我们就是在供应链结合我们的一些跨境支付的一些能力，以及供应链在供应链金融做了一些探索啊，我们服务一些北美的像大的电商平台，像 Wish、亚马逊，然后做了一个跨境业务的一些保理业务，主要是针对一些出口贸易的。我们未来可能还要探索更多的一些供应链场景，服务中小企业，并且去服务这种跨境的一些特定的一些贸易啊。谢谢大家。
好，谢谢刘总。So Dan, just for your benefit, Mr. Liu actually talked about regulation in China, and he also mentioned that even for software engineers, they become more risk conservative. So we chatted about the lawyers are very conservative. We actually hear a similar situation from the industry. So let's hear about the regulators, the lawyers' thoughts in the space. Dan, please.
Okay, thank you, Linja. So I'm Dan Nathan. I'm the attorney here, which means that people usually look to me to give the bad news. And for that reason, I don't get invited to a lot of parties. But I guess I can suffer that. And it's not all bad news. I'm with the law firm Auric, and we have a team of lawyers who try to give a full menu of services for anybody in the blockchain world. And any large firm that does this will provide those services. So anything from the financing end, raising money, doing an initial coin offering or raising funds more traditionally, introducing somebody who wants to bring a product to market to sources of financing, and then working on the technology contracts area, coming up with the terms of service and figuring out how to contract for the item. And then beyond that, looking at compliance, looking at whether the coin is a security or a commodity, looking at what sorts of policies and procedures need to be instituted to make sure that law is complied with, and looking at money transmitting and anti-money laundering laws, because the U.S. agencies and also foreign that look at transfers of funds are getting very involved in this area. And then finally, we also, if the need arises and regulators start asking questions, we're there to help represent companies or individuals if they have to speak to the government about that. My personal part of the world is the last part. It's the compliance part, it's the procedures, it's representing people before the government. So unfortunately, the developments in the area of late are what I called sort of the bad news. Some of the regulators got sort of a slow start in regulating the area, but they're catching up now. There are many more cases, much more guidance, many more pronouncements being made every week. And if I were just to focus on breakthroughs, which is the theme of our talk, there are many breakthroughs only in the last week, and I'll talk about some of them right now, and there are many more. The one bit of advertising I'll do here is to tell you that at ORIC, we just started a blog on blockchain events, and if you want to keep up with regular events, we're publishing all the time. It just went live last week, and if you go to ORIC.com and look right on our front page, you can click through and you can sign up for our blog, and I recommend it if you want to keep up with developments. So let me talk about a few recent events. The SEC, as I said, was a little slow in getting started, and sort of under their noses, Bitcoin and Ether started trading actively. Of late, they have been providing more guidance. As you may know, during the summer, the director of their Division of Corporation Finance, William Hinman, made a speech in which he said some fairly solid things. He said that in the current state, Bitcoin and Ether are not securities. Then again, most initial coin offerings that they're seeing now are securities, and they make the determination about what the reasonable expectation of the purchaser is. Are you investing, relying on somebody else to try to make money for you on the platform, or are you purchasing a token with the intention of using it for a utility, for a function, or of transmitting value? Because then it may not be a security. The good news is that much more recently, William Hinman said that they are working on a plain English guidance that will provide much more useful tools, the sorts of things we've been working on in our firm to try to help our clients, but they're going to come up with tools which will take at least some of the guesswork out of determining whether you are security or not. And I'll urge everybody to watch for it when it comes out. We'll analyze it on our blog, and I think that will be very helpful. The second very recent event is that the SEC brought its first case in the last week against a exchange, a platform. It was against the founder of something called Ether Delta, where tokens that are based on the ERC-20, that is the Ethereum sort of base, and that are created on top as a smart contract, it's where they're traded. And in bringing this case, the SEC basically said that many of the tokens, it wouldn't say how many or which ones, but many of the tokens traded on Ether Delta are securities. And it said that most of them have been trading since 2017 when the SEC came out with its DAO report, DAO, which was the first report which said that many tokens are securities. So it sort of says that the SEC is now looking at where these tokens are traded and are going to bring more cases, I'm betting, and you can all bet, they're going to bring many more cases against exchanges which are not registered with the SEC as exchanges if they're trading securities there. And interestingly, there's no fraud in that case. Many of the earlier cases brought by the SEC involved fraud. Now they're saying, even if there's no fraud, there's a reason why we have the securities laws and you have to comply with our laws. So that's where the SEC is now, and I think they're going to keep being active. Let's talk about the other big regulator in this area, the CFTC, the Commodity Futures Trading Commission. They brought a number of fraud cases and also some non-fraud cases, and there have been challenges in the court by the people they're suing to say, you know, whatever it is you said we did, you don't have jurisdiction. The CFTC doesn't because these are not commodities. And the CFTC has two decisions from federal courts, including one in the last couple of weeks, saying that no, these actually are commodities and the CFTC can bring cases. And I think that means they're going to bring more cases. There also was an interesting statement recently, a couple of weeks ago, by one of the commissioners of the CFTC, Commissioner Brian Quintenz, who is looking at smart coins. He made a wonderful speech, and I recommend it to anybody interested in the CFT's views on the technology. But he said in smart coins, if we're going to look at who is liable for them, he said we should include the individuals who developed the code, who developed the software that made this into a smart token, and on which they knew that their software would make this into a commodity, would make it into a thing that is regulated by the CFTC. So it's not just the exchanges, it's not just the issuers, it's not just the sellers, but the developers of the code can be liable based on what he said. And since he said it, you can bet enforcement is going to try to bring cases like that. Last, let me turn to the scariest thing that I'll talk about, which is taxes. Taxes are scary to everybody. And the IRS has determined, and in recent reports and statements, they've said that they think that there's a lot of underreported tax liability on income from trading in cryptocurrencies, including Bitcoin. Much of the trading may be overseas, but if it's a U.S. resident earning income through trading wherever it is, then it can be taxed by the IRS. The IRS has fought over a number of years to enforce a subpoena against Coinbase to get information about its customers, and it recently got relief in the court, meaning that Coinbase is required to give its data about people who traded through it to the IRS. And based on that information, the IRS is going to see who traded and who didn't report income, and they're going to bring cases there against those traders. And again, I said I can be a bummer and say negative, scary things. That may be the scariest thing of all, is going against people's income and revenue from that. So those are some of the recent events. Again, look at the blog, and I'm happy to answer questions about other developments in this area.
Okay, thank you, Dan. And last but not least, let's hear Kevin's thoughts.
So my role at Deloitte is overseeing all of blockchain for the U.S. as it relates to the real estate industry. So whether you are a developer of real estate from the ground up, whether you are buying or selling real estate assets in the U.S. or globally, or whether you are operating a current building that's been developed and has tenants and is stable, my job is to help you as global real estate companies realize where blockchain technology can and cannot provide value. Now, some of these slides I'm going to skip through because they're blockchain 101, and I'm happy to send all of this material out to anyone who wants it after the conference is over. But I'm going to skip to what I think is relevant, which is the world of real estate. So before I dive into specific use cases, let's just think about what has happened in the real estate industry since Bitcoin was created in 2008, right? There was a financial crisis, interest rates went to near zero, and not only in the US, but many other places. It was hard to mark assets to market, so there was a value of being able to find bargains that were depressed. And if you had dry capital, you made a lot of money from 2009 to about 2016. Because there were a ton of deals to be had, interest rates were low. Well, now that's not the case anymore. Interest rates are rising, cap rates are decreasing, and that's not only in the US, but in many countries. So now investors are demanding to know, how are you going to keep producing outsized returns? How are you going to give me the information I want on my assets as reporting requirements date? And that's where I think blockchain technology can add a lot of value. And I've divided that into a number of different use cases. The first thing I think where blockchain adds a ton of value is in the world of payments. We see it outside of real estate. Being able to send money from one operator to another across the globe in minutes or hours instead of days or weeks. And we do that by operating a decentralized network that doesn't rely on a bank or a clearinghouse or otherwise. Now, you just heard from Dan that those transactions are going to be liable for taxes. So You are, my advice is to use blockchain technology to facilitate speed and efficiency, not to avoid paying the tax man his or her due. So that is one thing to keep in mind. Another use case outside of payments is the idea of due diligence and search. There are a ton of websites out there and platforms that offer basically real-time real estate data, right? CoStar, MLS databases, CompStack, you can get a lot of different information should you desire it. But in today's world, you have to pay for monthly access for each different data set. And there's no guarantee that that data is all accurate. So if you took some of this data and put it onto a blockchain where it is immutable, therefore not editable, not deletable, right? This is data that once it's on there and verified is there forever and can be trusted. So our hope is that real estate companies will be able to build in parallel blockchain-based databases that have good property and asset performance data that they can use to, I think, do better analysis and therefore produce better investments. And then the last thing I would discuss on here is the idea of identity management. So real estate is by necessity an opaque market. We're getting money from various investors across the globe. We may not know where that money's coming from. Regulators are demanding more information. Well, a blockchain database is a way to verify third parties before transactions happen. We can have very, very efficient identity management and regulatory management such that all of that data can be provided to a regulatory authority when asked. I'm sure the Chinese government would appreciate this. And not only that, but if an auditor comes to you, all of the data and information is already there. So if I have any Deloitte audit colleagues in the room, I'm sorry in advance, but if you are trying to win business from a real estate client that uses blockchain, the audit bill is going to be smaller because all of that information is already there. Basically, what I just talked about falls into these three buckets: due diligence, how you buy and sell, data, how you store, and then management, when you own an asset, how you efficiently facilitate rent collection, eviction proceedings, etc. And so what I think is going to happen, sorry for skipping through, is here are where real estate companies are actually going to use this and are using it today. The first is putting all of the land data into a nationalized or local jurisdictionized database so that they can communicate between attorneys, appraisers, buyers, sellers, brokers, etc. So everybody can share the same data set and hopefully get to an agreement faster. The second use case is the facilitation of that agreement once they've all agreed. So I can settle payments, I can transfer title, I can collect rent, I can pay vendors, all based on smart contracts once those contracts are agreed to. So to hear that correctly, that means the attorneys of the world, the brokers of the world, they will still be valuable because you have to get to that agreement. But once you do, blockchain facilitates a very, very quick settlement and transaction. And the last thing is, after you've successfully run some real estate transactions and you want to raise a new fund, you're no longer limited to a REIT structure or a private illiquid structure that suffers a discount. You can tokenize every asset in your portfolio and raise that capital globally. Now, this is already happening. You'll notice the examples I give are in Europe because they're much more ahead of the curb. The entire land database in Sweden has been put on a blockchain. An entire commercial building in the Netherlands has been put onto a blockchain. That means sensors, the lease agreements, all of the data that goes into that building. Deloitte helped with that project. And then lastly, the idea of escrow and settlement is already happening at a German bank called ABN AMRO. Here are some of the companies that are on Deloitte's radar screen, startups in the real estate space that are doing good work. There are 250 different companies that my group is tracking, but these are the ones that actually have live platforms that are working, that have produced transactions. And once again, I will send all of these slides out to all of you that are taking pictures, I promise. When you go back to work tomorrow, when is blockchain right for you, whether you're a real estate company or a banker, et cetera? Just think about these five parameters. The two that matter are you sharing the data with people outside of your company? and are multiple people required to edit the data to get to an agreement? If those two things don't exist, you don't need blockchain. You need some other technology or a better workflow or a better team. Appreciate your time.
Okay, thank you, Kevin. And thanks for all the panelists to share their insights. We feel this has been very helpful. So let me ask the audience for two quick surveys. How many of you have invested in the blockchain or cryptocurrency space? Okay, I saw quite a few. And how many of you are starting up a blockchain foundation or community? Wow. So we actually have both investors and startups in the audience. So let's take a couple of minutes to ask each of our panelists to give some advice. First one is for investors. Help us understand how to identify the next blockchain unicorn. 刘总，我们下面的一个问题是说，对于投资者来说，请各位嘉宾给一些建议，如何去挖掘下一个区块链领域的独角兽。
Okay, I will start first. So honestly speaking, it's very hard to find out who is the next unicorn. But still, some directions we can follow. I think the first direction is like we need to solve the current. We need to find out how to solve the current bottleneck of the public blockchain. So that depends on because right now, as you know, the Bitcoin can only process like 3 to 5 transactions per second. It's very, very slow. So there is a lot of blockchain network. We are the new blockchain network, but as a layer one solution, it's very hard to solve. So we need to solve we need to find some solution at the layer two. So I think the next unicorn maybe come from the layer two solution provider. That's one direction to go. The second direction to go, the blockchain cannot be alone. It need to combine with some other technology. So I think there is some opportunity with blockchain and the AI, blockchain with cloud service, blockchain with the data, and blockchain with the finance. So all the combination point have some very big opportunity. Furthermore, I think another big opportunity is like we can create the STO, the security token offering. So all the infrastructure, all the service around the STO are gonna be a very good like investment direction. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I actually do not know how to identify the next unicorn, but I can give you advice for the current unicorn. So if you believe Coinbase, Huobi, Binance, OKCoin are unicorns of the industry, go join them, find a job with them, and get equity. That's it.
Thank you, Wilfred. And Catherine?
Sure. I think my view, like any emerging technology, they always go through three stages. You know, there needs to be a kind of for the infrastructure to mature first. Then there's a protocol development across different infrastructure. In this case, is a different chains, right? Public chains or you know, aligned chains or private chains. And then it will come to the massive use case adoptions or business applications. So I think for now, if you look at from an infrastructure perspective, you got to find some team or projects that they really good at getting the nice balance between the performance and scalability. I think that's the key thing, how we can solve that, overcome that challenge, and to be able to really mature that technology and for wider adoption. But I think other than the specific area in blockchain, then I think everything are still stay with a very fundamental investment principle, right? Which is you have to find a good team who really have a deep understanding of this technology, and also you feel that the area that they pick is has a bright future in terms of a nice feed with this technology.
Okay, thank you, Catherine. 刘总，哎，大家好。那个，其实刚才那个片子里面已经提到了，下一个可能的那个独角兽有可能是在供应链金融领域。
因为工业链金融它流程特别长，特别契合于这个区块链的这种技术特性。具体来讲的话，有可能是汽车工业链金融，也有可能是医药工业链金融，还有就是跨境贸易的工业链金融，他们都有大量的机会可能诞生出独角兽出来。其实这样的独角兽已经出现了，在上个月十月大概十五号左右，就是有一家企业大概诞生两周年的企业，它就经过了 C 轮投资融资，它融资了2.2亿美元，现在的估值大概是10.5亿美元左右，已经是够了一个独角兽的标准了。但是我觉得这个供应链场景的这个市场容量非常大，它有可能容纳不止一个独角兽，可能会有多个独角兽在里头诞生。谢谢。
好的，谢谢。Dan.
Yeah, look, none of us can really know, because if we knew who was going to succeed and carve out a new slice, we'd all be rich. What I can tell you in my position, I do have a number of companies come to me and explore possibilities of representation, of getting financing. And you can tell the difference between somebody who has a vague idea and they want to raise money and then develop it and try to support it versus somebody who has put in a lot of time developing the technology, developing the platform, developing the use, developing the marketing materials, and it's something that they've thought through, and looking at it, it just says it's more likely to succeed. It's a real thing, and the funds that they're going to raise to finance it are going to be put to good use versus the other ones where you just don't know.
Thank you, Dan.
So I meet, like Dan, I get pitched a lot, probably multiple companies per week. Please invest in us. Please be an advisor to our company. And there are a lot of people that come to us that have great technology chops. They know all of the coding platforms. They know the technology very well. But they're not solving a business problem. And you can have fantastic technology, but if it doesn't solve a business problem, no one's going to buy it. So even if you invest in the underlying cryptocurrency or token, it's not going to be worth anything because then there's no end customers. So if you're thinking about the next potential unicorn, there's just two things I would encourage you to think about. One, if we could unlock liquidity to real estate or any other asset, the token that is seen as the marketplace standard to transact that real estate is going to be worth billions of dollars. I don't know what that token is today. There's 100 different ones vying to be the winner. But once that winner is chosen, I guarantee you everyone who owns those tokens or a part of that company is going to be rich. The second one is intellectual property ownership. If you could track successfully the creator of a song or a movie or educational materials or news articles, and you could monetize access and use of that asset, that will be immensely valuable globally. So those two, I think, are the most opportune investments. But I would agree with Wilfred. If you identify that company, buying that token is great, but working for that company will make you much more rich.
Okay, great. Thank you, Kevin. And the last question is for startups. How to build a leading and sustainable blockchain company or foundation or startup? So we'll start with Patrick.
Okay. So my advice is, like, if you have a token, then you should realize from the day one you are already the public company. So you will take a higher risk than all the other startups like without a token, because it's a blockchain area. It's a new tech. It's a new risk. Intrusive, it's higher risk. And today, I think in most of the countries, it's a wild west. So be fully prepared and ask your lawyer.
So we have a lawyer here. Okay, thank you, Patrick and Wilfred.
Yeah, definitely you want to stay here for the long run. And the blockchain technology development isn't 1 year. It's a multi-year process. And the ecosystem requires you to have a very strong state power and to be successful.
Thank you, Wilfred. Kathy?
Yeah, my advice to the startup company who is in the process of fundraising, I would say never raise more than what you need in the current stage. Because I think, then you don't need to, regardless of how you raise it, through equity or secret token or utility token, so I think you should focus on how much you need to build something for the next 18 months. And focus on the value you bring to the community and focus on the product you will deliver in the next 18 months and to gain more trust. And then I think it would be much easier for you to have a second round to raise more capital to support your systems, the company's sustainable development.
Okay, thank you, Catherine.
刘总，这个问题呢，就希望您从专业角度给区块链领域的初创企业，能够给他们一些建议，如何去打造一个顶尖的，也是可持续发展的初创企业。对于初创企业，你要活得久，其实最重要的就是现金流。从短期来看的话，它可能首先肯定要做一些，还是要做一些项目，具体的实际的项目。一方面呢，能够把那些区块链的技术跟真实的场景能结合起来，知道哪个怎么去结合。第二个能够再接触一些具体的场景，获得一些比较真实的需求，这样的话，它能够理解抽象出一个更高层的一些需求来。从中期来看的话，还是得深刻的结合一些具有高利润潜质的一些具体的场景，做平台，把这个平台做大，这样的话，它的利润会更加稳定。那么从长期来讲呢？ 可能还是要做一些技术积累，就是说现在阶段的这个区块链技术还不够成熟，真正满足一些大规模的需求。所以我们现在也看到大量的企业，不管是这种像中超建立区块链研究院，还有大量的一些区块链的初创企业，也开始在做研究院，包括火币网啊，包括这个本体啊，都开始建立一些区块链的一些研究院。你就实际上这都是从长期来看的发展。
埋下做一些打下一些基础。好，谢谢刘总 ，Dan。
I was going to say the first step is to hire a lawyer, but he stole my line. So instead, I'll borrow Kevin's line, which is make sure you have a clear business case. Try it out on people. You're going to be talking to venture capitalists or possible sources of financing. Show it to them. Make sure it presents a good, strong case. And try it out on people, have a mock-up developed, have it ready for that while protecting your intellectual property. Make sure you're not giving it away and you have full protections, but the more you socialize it, circulate it among people to get views, the more likely it is you're going to get some success.
And while you're picking that business case and shopping it with venture capital investors, I would also pitch that business case to who would be your potential customers. If you're solving a business problem, go to who would be a strategic investor. And if they like that business case and they want to solve that problem, maybe they will give you your first tranche of capital. And then you avoid giving up too much equity to VCs. And if you solve that problem, they invest with you. And you can use their customer base, their vendors, as guinea pigs themselves as you grow.
Well, thank you. Thank you for all these great insights and great advice. And our audience, let's give a round of applause to our panelists. They travel from Asia, Dallas, and DC, and we really appreciate their support to TCFA. Thank you.